Hi guys, good morning. So we are going to start off with the EIS crash course, and herein we will be dealing all the 5 chapters. So I hope everybody is able to see things live, and you guys have a chat box. You can always tap in to the chat box, and we will also find you know, the way you can put up a comment there. If at all you have any doubts during the session, you can always put it across to me. And then once I'm through to it, I will also come and check the the comment box, and I will answer your queries as well. So meanwhile, what I would want to start off is give you a basic idea on how this is going to work. So we have 5 chapters, and I hope everybody has got the PDF material that we have sent. We can't courier the materials right now, so which is one of the reasons why we have given you the PDF. So you can kind of try and keep it parallelly. Of course, you can focus around with the class that is going to go on. Alongside that, we can always look back and understand things. So in EIS, we have 5 chapters. As you know, all the 5 chapters have exquisite content on respective areas. Like the first one talks about automating a business environment, and then further the second chapter talks about financial and operating systems. The third one is on information systems with respective concepts. So like that, in different areas are covered in different chapters. So there is no exclusive continuity or something like that. So it's all 5 varied chapters, with the third one being a vast chapter as well. So keeping that in consideration, let us talk about how things are to be taken here. So as you see, EIS, as part of the crash course, I will be covering again all the 5 chapters mostly, but for small 1 or 2 concepts, but for them we'll be covering everything. So in this, first we will start with chapter number 1. Chapter 1 is on automated business environment. Automated business environment. So in this chapter on automated business environment, we will be talking about why automation is necessary, how it works, what are the steps involved in doing automation. So all these are some of the concepts that we will be looking down in the particular topic related to this one. Okay, so on that note, we will basically try and understand how this entire series of sequence of events work. So this concept on automated business environment, this deals with something which is called as BPA, the business process automation. So why do we need automation? What are the benefits of automation? What should you automate? We got to discuss all this. But in the process of discussing all these, first things first, we need to understand what exactly are the processes that we are trying to automate. So before I start, what exactly BPA means, we need to try and understand what is the classification of processes, because this is very important. When you know what are the various types of process, only then you can go ahead and see what exactly will be your automation of those processes. So process of 3 types here. We have 3 types of process. What are the 3 types of process? If you see, first one is called operational process. The first one is called operational process. Then next one is called supporting process, and next one is called management process. Operating process, management process, and support process. Now you know this operating process are day to day things, right? What do you do? This one, procurement of all the goods and raw materials, all these are called operating processes. Whereas management process are the ones that are important in decision making and other activities, they are called as operating process. While we talk about support process like HR and finance, they are called as support process. So all these are something to deal with the types of process. Now what you need to understand from here, if you see the types of process, we did talk about these 3 types of process, right? So taking these 3 processes into consideration, we need to have an understanding of how these processes will be automated, how these 3 processes will be automated, and which is what? These three processes when automated, that is business process when they are automated, that is only termed as a BPA, the business process automation. So that is what we are trying to understand in this chapter. What is the concept of BPA? So I hope you guys are having the material alongside. So you can do one thing, you can scroll on to the first part of the material. The first part of the material talks about what are the three types of process. Operational process, they are also called as primary process. I believe you know the Michael Porter's value chain. You remember Michael Porter's value chain? The Michael Porter's value chain analysis talked about two types of process, the primary process and the support process. So just exactly like that, here we have the points to discuss, which are the three types of process. The first one, it is called an operational process. Operational process, nothing but the ones that deal with the core business and value chain activities, the primary activities, that is nothing but, you know, procurement of raw material, which is called inbound logistics. Inbound logistics, conversion or operations. Then we have outbound logistics. So all these, and I mean that marketing, sales, everything that takes, and sales and after sales service. So all these points that you see here, these are all totally what are called as the primary activities. They are all inbound primary activities. Then management activities, which are nothing but management activities. Okay, we'll see if these operating activities are to work, we need the support process. You know what support processes are? Support processes are something that will help the operating process to work, like, you know, HR, finance, infrastructure, all these are called as support process. Okay, so support process back the core process and functions within an organization. One key differentiator between operational and support process is that support process do not provide value to customers directly. They do not provide value to customers directly. However, hiring the right people for the right job has a direct impact. You remember this word called staffing? Staffing is about putting the right person in the right place, which is what they're talking about now. Staffing. The staffing is an aspect of putting the right person in the right place. So if your operating and support processes are these, then the next process that we are talking about is a management process. You know what a management process is? All managerial aspects, the managerial decisions that are taken. Management process measure, monitor and control activities. Management process, what do you do? Measure, monitor and control activities related to a business process and system, like support process. Again, support process, who are the supporters, what are the supporting process, these are not things that are visible, okay, directly. So you have to see what these things are and how they work, understood? So management process are also like that only, they are not visible directly to the front line. Those processes that are visible to the front line process, they are called as operational process, or they are also called as face to face, or they are called the front end process. But when you talk about management and support, they're there behind them, and that's how they get them going. So I hope you are following this particular aspect here. What is it called as? That is only called as the three processes. What are the three processes? The operational process, supporting process and the management process. Now we know that these three processes are the set of processes that are being worked up. Now the bigger question that arises is, can these process be performed manually? Can these process be performed manually? Yes, 100%, no doubt, these process can be performed absolutely manually. Having said that, now like say you, I'm telling that you can do it manually. But the point being, when you can do these process manually, what are the dangers? I'll tell you what. One, they are very slow. That is, you know, efficiency is less. The possibility of a human error, I'm saying, etc. There are enough number of reasons which I don't think I'll tell you as to why computers or why automation is required. We will speak about them once again now in this benefits part. But then all I am trying to tell you is, manually all these processes were performed. They were performed. Now also they are being performed. Nothing wrong with that. But having said that, having said all of that, it is important for you to understand that in this context, whichever we are dealing with right now, these three processes, when automated, will now be called as BPA, business process automation, or in other words, it's called as automated business environment. So that is exactly what the very first part of our discussion is. So in this chapter, yeah, what do you mean by a business process, and what are the three categories of process? As I just told you, the definition of BPA, once I'm reading out, you can check your PDFs along with that. So what is the definition of BPA? It's a technology enabled. BPA is nothing but a technology enabled. BPA is a technology enabled automation of activities or services. Technology enabled automation of activities or services that accomplish a specific function. So it's technology enabled, it is automated, and it will achieve a special purpose or a special function. That's what we are trying to understand. So guys, as I go with here, I hopefully am able to, you know, pick this up, and I am hoping that, you know, you guys are understanding the basics here, because once we know this clearly, because the next topic that we are going to see, which is called BPA, has all the varied aspects of how these go on. Okay, so let us continue here. So I hope you understood the definition. BPA is nothing but what? A technology enabled. So you're using technology to what? Do automation for all these specific business functions. It's a technology enabled automation of activities or services to accomplish specific functions, and can be implemented for many different functions, and can be implemented for many different functions of the company activities, including sales, management, operations, supply chain, HR. So as you see, all those functions are being taken care of. Okay, so what is BPA, guys? A technology enabled automation of all these aspects, so that once you do know automation. See, again, automation is not compulsory. Nobody told that. But having said that, if you want to go around doing things faster, automation today is more like a mandatory aspect. So what benefits does it bring in? How do we go for automation? That's what we are going to see next. So I want you to read once again the definition as we deal with it further. So let me go on and deal with that further here. BPA, the major concept. So the five parts is definition, guys. I mean, five parts is this topic called BPA. First, as we saw now, BPA goes with the definition. Okay, what is the definition of BPA? What are the definitions? So I hope you guys are catching up with that. So it is nothing but what? Definition of BPA is nothing but technology enabled automation. It's technology enabled automation of business process. Technology enabled automation of business process, which are key, or which are the various important aspects. That's what are called as the, that is what is the aspect of BPA. Let us now go on to the second topic in BPA. What are the benefits? What are the benefits of doing BPA? You're going with automation. So what are the benefits that are involved in dealing with this is also something that we need to understand. Let me give you a shortcut here. We have 7 points. So QVIT, and then the three R's. That's what The 7 points are quality and consistency, visibility. So like that, we have the 7 points to deal with. Look at the benefits. We will deal one by one, keeping the acronym in mind. So first one, quality and consistency. Quality and consistency. Then visibility. Improved operational efficiency. Improved operational efficiency. Definitely the next one is called time saving. We know this because saving a lot of time doing automation. Then we have the next one called as reliability. Reliability and governance. We're changing that. Reliability and governance. Then we have reduced turnaround time. Reduced turnaround time. And reduced cost. So all these are the 7 advantages of why should we do BPA. Because once you're doing BPA, right? Obviously, there needs to be some benefit. Simply, nobody wants to do some BPA activity, right? So let's go ahead, find out what are the 7 points here. Come on. Quality and consistency. Talking about that. Guys, see, only you and I as human beings, we tend to be partial. Like sometimes we're like, all right, this is important activity, so you have more focus. This is a less important activity, so we need not focus. We are the ones who do that. But when it comes to, computer, whether it's a small transaction or a big transaction, it doesn't matter to the system. All these things actually don't matter to the system, because in the system, no, everything is treated with consistency. Consistency is a key in the systems arena. Okay, so quality and consistency when you're talking about it. So consistency is that factor. So that is why every transaction happens in the same manner. And when every transaction happens in the same manner, there is no, thing like one transaction is having more importance than the other and all that. So quality and consistency, they both work along. Then we have the second point, which is talking about visibility. How much activity is being done? How much activity is done? How much is yet to be done? All these are some of the points again with respect to visibility. So I think we can read these 2 points is given there. See their first and third point. Ensures all activities are performed identically, means the same manner. So there is no overemphasis on something or there is no less emphasis on something. Then visibility. Automated processes are controlled and consistently operate accurately. How much process done, like say 60% is done, 70% is done in manual. If I'm rendering a particular service or giving some work, I will not be able to tell you how much is done. I can't show you, though I know in my mind that so much is done. Can't exactly give you, but here there is visibility. That means this portion of work is done and this portion of work is not done. We can actually talk about that. Then we are talking about improved operational efficiency. Automation reduces the time it takes. So what earlier took 1 hour can now be finished in lesser time. Obviously, no, like see, we can do things much faster. So automation reduces the time it takes to achieve the task, the effort required to undertake it, and the cost of completing it successfully. If you guys have taken a printout, underline some of these points. If you guys haven't taken a printout, it's not compulsory that you guys have a print. If you are able to have a PDF and mark it through there, it's good. If you guys have already printed it out or you are willing to print it for the next class, you can as well comfortably do it. So do not worry, do not take any tension. We can coolly read and understand each and every concept, be very sure about it. We have enough and ample time on hand. So, we can do all this coolly right now. So, yeah, quality and consistency, visibility, improved operational, and of course, time saving is an aspect. Now, efficiency increases from the employee standpoint. Time saving is from the overall perspective. How much time is saved? See, obviously, you know what earlier took, definitely what earlier took 1 hour will now get done in less than 1 hour. Now, I can't say whether it gets done in half an hour. Or will it take 3 hours, 30 minutes, or 40 minutes, 50 minutes, I don't know. But what earlier took 1 hour physically will definitely take less than that when it comes to, even if it's done in 50 minutes. Sir, you are saving only 10 minutes, but I still saved, right? So, what happened? But, you know, like manually counting cash, and putting that cash into an automatic cash counting machine, you know the difference of how quick and accurate things are. So, which is exactly what automation is benefiting. So, QVIT, the 4 points: quality and consistency, visibility, improved operational efficiency and time saving. Also, along with that, we have reliability and governance. Reliability and governance. Turnaround time. What is turnaround time? I hope you know what is turnaround time. Time taken to complete one full process. Time taken to complete one full process. This is a time taken to complete one full process, that is only called as a turnaround time. Reliability and governance, reduce turnaround time, and obviously the cost will definitely come down. So let us just read the last 3 points to wind this one up. So you're talking about that. So governance and reliability. The consistency of automated process means that stakeholders can rely on the business process to operate and offer reliable process to customers and maintain a competitive advantage. Then turnaround time, as I told you, you can eliminate unnecessary task, and realign steps to optimize the flow of information. Realign the process steps to optimize the flow of information throughout the production, service, billing and collection. This adjustment of process distills, means breaks down, the operational performance and reduces the turnaround time for both staff and external customers. Also look at the reduced cost here. Manual tasks, given that they are performed only one at a time and at a slower rate than the automatic task, will obviously cost you more. And automation allows us to accomplish more by utilizing few resources. So using less of resources, and you will be able to get more out of it. So I believe that these 7 are good number of benefits that are able to, you know, help us try and understand what exactly this entire aspect of BPA is all about. So what are we looking at? What is the definition of BPA? What are the benefits of BPA? And the last thing to look for here are the steps involved. Steps involved in BPA. What are the steps involved in BPA? 8 steps are there. I want you to understand what these 8 steps are, because this potentially is an exam question. It has come in the past. It can always come again. Now, whether that will come as a, I mean, one of these 8 steps will come as a question, or probably they ask you to write down the 8 steps. What is it going to be? That we will be discussing here. So, let us see how that works. So step number 1, we are going to talk about why BPA. Step number 1 on why BPA. When everything is going fine, why do you want to do BPA? There should be good number of reasons just to say why BPA. Because see, simply when everything is going fine, nobody would want to do a BPA. So the first thing that we are dealing with the question is why we are doing the BPA. Then we are talking about define why BPA and plan to do. See, in the name of doing BPA, you should again not do something which is illegal. So we are going to talk about that as well. Understanding the rules and regulations. Why BPA? Understanding the rules and regulations. Then we talk about documenting the existing process. Then step number 4, we're talking about setting goals and objectives. I'll explain this. It's a very important point. Setting goals and objectives. And since we haven't done this exercise before and this is the first time that we're doing an automation activity, it is better that we don't do things on our own. That is, we don't want to do things on our own. We will be doing it by taking help of somebody who is an expert in this area. Who is he called as? They are only called as engaging business process consultant. Business process consultant. Now, business process consultant is somebody who is well versed, whose daily activity is about to do BPA. So, their major aspect of the regular work involves, helping companies set up the BPA and all that. Also, not to forget, we have our top management who should give a go ahead for this. So, step number 6 is of calculating the ROI, because you need to take their, consent in doing this, and they will be happy only when you are able to give them a proper connect on ROI. So, this much you are investing, this much you are going to get back. And point number 7 is development of BPA. Development of BPA. And finally, point number 8 is testing of BPA. So, since no aspect goes into implementing directly, so development and testing of the BPA. So, these are the 8 aspects that are involved here, guys. So, I want you to take a clear look at all these points on how do you go about dealing with the 8 steps involved in BPA. So, I hope it's clear on your screen that all these 8 steps are being discussed. So, let us start reading up all these 8 steps and trying to have a understanding. So, I hope everything is going cool and clear. So, let us talk about these 8 steps now. As part of the 8 steps, I want you to read the first one as to why we are dealing with BPA. The primary purpose for which enterprise implements automation obviously will vary from enterprise to enterprise. If you ask somebody, why are you doing automation? Now, here you should understand something. Why are you doing automation is more a personal question to everybody. There is no reason why everybody has to give you a same answer for that, right? So, some people may tell they are doing automation for cost benefits, while some people may be telling that they are doing it for some other reason. So, there are enough number of reasons as to why somebody is doing BPA. Not everybody needs to do BPA only because of XYZ reasons. They have enough number of reasons as to why we can do the BPA. The primary purpose for which an enterprise does BPA may vary from enterprise to enterprise. Some general reasons, a list is given, as I already told you, there are gaps in manual processing, sometimes that does not work. So, there are enough number of reasons as to why they are doing BPA. Let us catch up with some of those. Like some of the reasons that are given here, errors in manual processing can lead to high cost. Payments are not streamlined, and since payments are not streamlined, sometimes it results in duplicate payments. Duplicate payments are happening, so that means you end up paying twice. So, that is not a great sign of, dealing things with. So, errors in manual processing leading to higher cost. Payments not streamlined due to which duplicate payments are happening. And payment process is not streamlined. The payment process is not streamlined. And missing or conflicting data, paying for goods or services that have not yet been received, poor debtor management is happening, leading to high invoice aging. That means from lot of days you are not able to collect from your debtors. Paying for goods and services that are not received, not able to find documents during the audit. Now you want documents during the audit, you want to find them quickly and give a solution. That's not coming during the audit. Not being able to find documents quickly during an audit or lawsuit. Lengthy or incomplete new employee or new account onboarding. You're unable to recruit and train new employees. But where employees are urgently required, because your onboarding process is very slow, you're unable to get people and put up them in the job. Lack of management understanding of the business process. Now, this sounds very dull because management is not able to set up and implement the best process. So, which is exactly also one more problem. And poor customer service. I think we have enough number of reasons as to say why we should go for a BPA aspects. Right? So, define why BPA. More than one reason is to do the BPA. And so, you can safely, try and understand that BPA is not some random activity. It has some valid reasons behind doing the activity of BPA. But please understand, in the name of doing BPA, calling it BPA and other things, you should not end up doing things which are illegal. Things which are illegal you can't do. So how will I know then what is legal and illegal? For which you need to understand the laws and regulations. Let us now see what are we speaking about, laws and regulations. Step number 2, understanding the rules and regulations are a very important aspect. Governance is established by a combination of internal corporate policies, external industry regulations and local, state and central laws. Regardless of the source, it is important. That means from where it comes, what is start, that's not the point. But regardless of the source, it is important to be aware of their existence and how they affect the documents that drive the process. It is important to understand that laws may require documents to be retained. Now, you know, like say books of account that we retain for so many years, like books of account that we retain for 8 years, right? Like that documentation has to be retained for 7 years. So like that different things go by different laws, they have to be retained for so many years. And can you keep them in electronic form or not? All these are points that we need to take into consideration. That will be discussed in the respective laws and regulations. Also to go around with, third point, the very important one. What is step number 3? Document the existing process, because you are going to automate this process. Now all of you need to understand one thing here. Automating a wrong process, whatever process there, automating a wrong process will not take you anywhere. Automating wrong process will get you wrong results faster. So to avoid that, getting wrong results faster, what you need to do is to automate the right process, for which you should know what is the existing process. Let us see this. Document the process we wish to automate. Aspects need to be kept in mind while documenting the process. 1, what document need to be captured? What documents need to be captured? Where do they come from? What format are they in? Who is involved in processing of these documents? What is the impact of regulations? Like how long should you maintain and what should you do with it? What are the impact of regulations? Can there be a better way to do the same job? Is there a better way to do the same job? And how are exceptions in this process handled? How are the exceptions in this process handled? All these are some of the points that we need to take into consideration. The benefit of the above process for the user and entity. The benefit of the above process for the users and entity. It provides clarity. So very important, documenting the existing process will give you an idea on the clarity aspects as to whether it's important to understand or not. It will get you a clarity. It helps to determine the source of inefficiency. That means where we are lacking, what is going wrong, all that. It helps to determine the sources of inefficiency, bottlenecks and problems. And it also allows to redesign the process. It allows to redesign the process to focus on desired result with workflow automation. Desired result with workflow automation. So, if step 1, step 2, step 3 are done very clearly, you will know why should you do BPA. Not only that, you will also have an understanding of the rules and regulations and also deal with this. You also have a clear understanding of what constitutes to the current process. If you are sure and clear about all these 3 areas, now what's more important and what is needed here is the goals of future, wherein you are going to follow what is called as a SMART goal setting approach. SMART, you're going to follow what? A SMART goal setting approach. S-M-A-R-T, specific, measurable, attainable, relevant and timely. SMART goal setting approach. So what is the SMART goal setting approach? See, when determining goals, remember that goals need to be SMART. Why are they supposed to be SMART? Because that's what I'm talking about. Specific. Goals need to be specific. Measurable in terms of monetary terms. Measurable. Specific. Measurable. Attainable. Attainable. For relevant. And T stands for timely. specific, measurable, attainable, relevant, and timely. These are how the goals are to be established. Goals be specific, goals need to be measurable, goals need to be attainable. You can't set up some goals like say I can't keep walking on earth until plants upon the moon. Okay, understand. So it should be attainable within the limited capacity that you have, within the money that you have, within the resources that you have. You need to determine all this very clearly. So specific, measurable, attainable, relevant, and timely. This is how the goal is supposed to be. Now, if why BPA understood, understanding the rules and regulations, documenting the existing process, setting up goals and objectives. Then, as I told you sometime back, this is not something to be considered as a activity that you can do on your own self. I'm not saying that you can't do it on yourself. All I'm saying is we are not experienced on this at all. And once we know that we are not experienced with this, it is important for us to take this into consideration and deal with things that we need to have a proper understanding of, for which you need to know that these things, somebody is well versed in doing all this. They are only called as business process consultants or business process, process consultants who are, like third party vendors whose daily business is to do this only. They'll come and help you with the installation. They'll help you with all the setup. They will take care of all this. So these are the guys who do this day in and day out. So in their opinion and idea, we can take help of them. Consultant should be able to suggest you what you need. But again, so many consultants are there in the market. Whom do you go about choosing it? To decide as to which company or consultant to partner with will depend on the following. What are those? Objectivity of the consultant. In understanding or evaluating the entity's situation. Does the consultant have experience with entity business process? Is the consultant experienced in resolving critical business issues? Whether the consultant is capable of recommending, and implementing a combination of hardware, software, and services as appropriate to our requirements. So, is he somebody who is well versed in this? Will he suggest us what do we want and all that? And does the consultant have required expertise to clearly articulate the business value of every aspect of the proposed solution. So, is he somebody who will help us in dealing things? Yeah, if the answer is yes, then it's fine. No, so they are not somebody who is great suggesting us, then probably you might want to take the other thing into consideration. So, and then step number 6, don't think any problem is there. All of you guys are financial management students. You understand the importance of ROI, the return on investment. See, BPA is not some simple funny activity, right? BPA is something that you need to do wherein you got to put up a lot of money and effort. So, when you know that it's going to cost you some money and effort, it's important for us to understand that, we will be spending a little bit on our, entire setup. So, therefore, it should be fetching back a revenue. What is that cost savings that are made? Cost savings due to this. You're going to stop using the paper much, and since you're going to stop using paper, there will be a savings in terms of that place and all that. Definitely there will be a savings in terms of that. And how BPA can lead in reduction in manpower, eliminating the fines to be paid, reduction in cost of the audit, and now that your system tells you due dates and all on time, how quickly can we pay back on time? All those are also to be considered, can be taken into consideration. Ensuring complete documentation of all new accounts, new revenue generation opportunities, and collecting accounts receivable faster, and improving the cash flow. Building business by providing superior levels of customer service and charging for instant access to records. Charging for what? Instant access to records. That is, now that you can see the ROC, MC, all these people, they made public documents available and they're making us pay for them. As such, they are regularly available. So if you are happy with all these 6 points, that's when we need to go ahead and consider what we will be doing in developing a BPA. See, because if the ROI calculation don't suggest you that they're going to work well, then probably you might want to go about dropping the idea of putting up the BPA. So once all the requirements have been documented, ROI has been computed and top management approval has been given, the consultant develops the requisite BPA, and the developed BPA needs to meet the requirements for which the same is being developed. And step number eight, not only this, any step, anything that we do in automation, unless you test it, you are not going to implement it further directly into the system. So you will cross check it once and only then you will implement that into the point. It's important to test. It is important to underline, test the new process or highlight and keep that part. It is important to test the new process, determine how well it works and identify where additional exception processing steps need to be included. The process of testing is underlined and iterative. Iterative means repetitive. Iterative is nothing but repetitive. Iterative process is nothing but a repetitive process. So taking that into consideration, it's tested iteratively till the time we have the understanding. Testing allows room for improvements. Testing allows room for improvement prior to the official launch. Prior to the official launch of the, prior to the official launch of the new process, and also increases user adoption. Suddenly one fine day you say from tomorrow you are going to use this, users will start panicking and they get confused. So you don't want that. So thereby, testing allows room for improvements prior to the official launch of the new process. It increases user adoption and decreases resistance to change. And it decreases what? Resistance to change. Documenting the final version of the process will help to capture all this hard work. With the help of, thinking that an experience which can be used to train new people. So all this can be done and it can be tested, it can be taken into consideration. So all of which as to how this is working and seeing you can test it and make sure that you have a proper sense into the understanding. So what are business processes? First we talked about various business processes, the three types of business process. Then we discussed about what constitutes to the definition or what constitutes to pretty much the automation part. And then we discussed the benefits, the steps involved in BPN. So I hope the first part is clear, right? You guys can go around and run through all of what we discussed right from the beginning. The three processes, the definition of BPA, benefits and steps involved in BPA. The whole concept. Then we're going to talk about some of the most important parts of the story here in BPA. There are also a couple of amendments in this area. 6-7 new terms have been introduced. So risk and all the related terms. What is the concept of ERM, Enterprise Risk Management? I will deal all that in the next part. So I want you to just take a quick look at all these points so that we can go ahead and then move on to the next topic. Right? That's what about the first topic in this chapter, BPA, is all about.